Thousands of voters are already applying to vote by mail in Texas. Why officials say a recent court ruling lets you decide if you're eligible. Families struggling to get in touch with loved ones.
It hurts. And I need to hear her voice.
New federal funding aims to connect people in nursing homes. Why it will take more than money to make it work. Texas Democrats turned their convention into a virtual event, but the candidates running for Senate will meet face to face in a debate. How the virus has changed that race. Hello, and thank you for joining us for State of Texas. I'm Josh Hinkle. More Texans are expected to vote by mail in the July runoff and in the 2020 presidential election because of COVID-19. Wednesday, the Texas Supreme Court ruled that a lack of immunity to COVID-19 cannot be the only reason to request a mail-in ballot. But politics reporter John Engel found out the court left the final decision to voters.
The Texas Supreme Court ruled that voters should take their own health into account when deciding to request a mail-in ballot.
If a voter is concerned that they have a condition or a sickness, that means that they can't show up in the polling place without taking the risk of injuring their own health, then that voter has every right to vote by mail.
County clerks review applications but do not investigate claims of disability.
If a voter has a condition such as asthma, diabetes, any other kind of immunocompromised system, if the voter has comorbidities, all of those are going to be included in the voter's judgment about asking for a ballot by mail.
The application to request a mail-in ballot is actually pretty simple. There's one little box that asks if you have a disability, but other than that, it doesn't define what a disability is or ask you what your disability is. Attorney General Ken Paxton still contends that a disability means you physically can't get to the polls, but Texas election code says a sickness falls under the umbrella of disability.
Not your fear that somehow by going to the polls, you'll get worse. That's not even close to what we're talking about.
This was kind of the outcome.
Jake Pugh of Austin has suffered from asthma and plans to apply for a mail-in ballot, fearful too that he could bring something home to his family.
It becomes a real balancing act of, do you risk bringing that, you know, exposure in, or is voting more important? And I just don't like to have to make that decision.
For State of Texas, I'm John Engel.
Thanks, John. If you think you could qualify for a mail-in ballot, you have to apply soon. Your county clerk must receive your application by July 2nd to qualify for the July runoff elections. We took a closer look at just how many Texans vote by mail. In the last two big election years, it's been between 4 to 4.5%. In 2018, when Texas statewide offices were up for vote, more than 500,000 mail-in ballots were counted. That's out of 8.3 million votes cast. In the last presidential election in 2016, less than 450,000 mail-in ballots were counted. That was out of close to 9 million votes cast. Currently, there is some partisan divide on mail-in voting, but a majority of Americans are in favor of the idea. Look at the latest results from a Gallup poll. Close to two-thirds of Americans support the concept. More than 80% of Democrats favor the idea. Independents are more than two-thirds in support, and 40% of Republicans want mail-in voting. Younger voters support mail-in voting the most, but no matter the age bracket, Gallup found a clear majority of those who responded wanted the option. It's been almost 3 months since visitors were banned from nursing homes, and several families have reached out to our investigators struggling to get in touch with their loved ones. Now the government is stepping in to help. The governor's office announced $3.6 million in funding to help nursing homes buy tablets, webcams, and headphones. The money comes from the federal government. Nursing homes can apply for up to $3,000 to help residents virtually connect with their loved ones. But investigator Avery Travis heard concerns that new devices are only one step toward getting everyone connected.
I've been calling for like 2 months.
Brenda Blackshear says she still can't get through to talk to her aunt in a nursing home.
It hurts. And I need to hear her voice.
While some seniors have their own phones, many don't.
Nursing facilities are required to have a resident phone available. But that's a shared phone, and in these days, that's going to be a real challenge.
There are state and federal guidelines on providing access to communication.
But there's no requirement as to how often.
Buckner Senior Villas has dedicated an employee to help schedule and facilitate virtual visits.
Family and friends was the thing that they missed the most.
A survey of their residents reveals 55% had never used video calling before, and 52% of residents say they'll keep using it even when the homes reopen.
To jump on a quick call, more residents are even texting these days.
Even with more funding to provide some of these new devices, advocates are worried that some homes won't have the staffing or the resources to help residents get started using them.
Particularly folks who have memory issues, being able to really see their loved ones.
AARP is pushing for more requirements, things like at least one tablet per facility that can be disinfected and reused, or scheduled calls a few times a week.
You don't need one for every resident to make it work.
I'd be the happiest person in the world.
In Austin, Avery Travis for State of Texas.
Thanks, Avery. Facilities do have to apply for the new funding with Health and Human Services. The agency recommends homes use it to provide one device for every 7 to 10 residents. But large facilities can apply for an exception. And patients who've tested positive for the coronavirus should not have to share devices with other residents.
A state lawmaker answers questions about why Texas is not releasing thousands of prisoners approved for parole. The questions come as many people sit in units where the coronavirus is still spreading.
I think that the problems that were here before COVID are just magnified now, and my type of leadership style is what's needed.
The virus leads Texas Democrats to hold a virtual convention, but one big event will happen face-to-face, a debate between the candidates in the Senate runoff.
I have demonstrated my ability to bring people together. I'm a true Democrat.
We'll hear from Royce West and MJ Hagar about how the virus has changed this key race and what to expect in next week's debate.